This graph shows total US credit market debt as published by the Fed in early 2012. It includes government debt, which is all the bonds issued by the Treasury. It also includes corporate and financial debt, which is any debt that companies, financial and otherwise, have taken on. And even household debt of private citizens, like mortgages and credit card debt, is included. The vertical axis on this chart is denominated in billions of dollars. So what you can see here is that the total US credit market debt surpassed $50 trillion in 2007. A trillion is a million millions, a one followed by 12 zeros. Quite an astonishing number. Now, the first striking thing in this graph is that until very recently, it has been growing every year. Before 2008, there was not a single year where total US credit market debt did not grow. Even through all the recessions, indicated by the shaded areas, it always kept rising. Only in 2008, for the first time since the Fed started taking records, debt growth in the US stagnated. This should give a lot of people pause who are claiming that this is just another hiccup, like many before, and that everything will be back on track in no time. But what is even more interesting than the fact that it kept rising strictly monotonously until 2008 is the actual growth pattern itself. Let's start with 1950. In 1950, there were roughly $400 billion of total US credit market debt. It took until 1961, 11 years, for total debt to double for the first time. It took another 10 years until 1971 to double again. Then, after only 6 more years, it doubled yet again. And again, 7 years later in 1984. And again, another 6 years later in 1990. And again, 10 years later in 2000. And by 2008, total US credit market debt had doubled one last time, reaching the staggering amount of roughly $53 trillion. This makes 7 doublings in less than 60 years, with an average of 1 doubling every 8.5 years, growing the market roughly 128 times its original size from 1950. So, the growth of debt in the US clearly follows, or rather, followed, an exponential pattern. Having presented data to support my first claim, let's turn to my second claim about the different kinds of money. Again, you can look this up yourself for more details on the homepage of the St. Louis Fed. What this graph shows is 4 different ways to measure money. The simplest measure is perhaps the actual physical paper currency, the reserve notes that were actually printed and spent into the economy, as represented by the blue line. So there is only $1 trillion or so of actual physical currency in existence. Next up, the red line represents base money. Again, we see an interesting pattern. Until 2008, practically all the base money there were actual reserve notes, but in 2008 it diverged aggressively. So, what is base money if not physical currency? Well, any claims against the Federal Reserve. Remember, if you have a checking account with the Fed, you can demand actual currency for it. But all the digital money that was created in 2008 did not get converted into physical currency, but is actually just sitting on the balance sheet of commercial banks as excess reserves. The next monetary aggregate, represented by the green line, is M1, funds that are readily accessible for spending. It includes checking accounts and all the currency that is actually in circulation in the economy and does not just sit in some bank vault. So, where's the money multiplier? For that, we have to look at M2, the orange line, which also includes, among other things, savings accounts, where most people keep most of their money nowadays. There used to be an even broader measure of money in the US, called M3, but the Fed stopped publishing that number a few years ago. Of course, similar aggregates for the euro can be found on the ECB website. So, now that I have presented some data to support my claims, let's turn to the second question I posed in the beginning. Why is perpetual economic growth so important? To find an answer, let's start by looking at government debt. We will again use the United States as an example. This graph represents the bond debt of the US government, more than $15 trillion. It was part of the previously shown total US credit market debt, but here, in 2008, something interesting happens. While total credit market debt began stagnating in 2008, government bond debt took off. Perhaps this should come as no surprise. We already concluded that debt has to keep growing if one wants to avoid widespread defaults. And since the private sector stopped taking on additional debt in 2008, the government had to step in as well as it could to prevent the total collapse. It is very hard to appreciate the magnitude of all the numbers in these three charts, so let's visualize them to get a better impression. We start with a $100 reserve note, the largest denomination of paper currency available in the US. Next up, $10,000, or 100 $100 bills, stacked on top of each other, a little more than the average credit card debt per family in the US in 2012. If we stack 100 such bundles, we get to $1 million, or about 20 years of pre-tax income for the median American household. 100 of those stacks give us $100 million, about the price of a large city office building. With 10 such stacks, we reach $1 billion, only 1/700th of the TARP money used in 2008 to prop up the banking system. 1,000 billions make a trillion. 2/3 of the projected budget deficit of the United States for the fiscal year 2011. Those pallets are, by the way, double stacked. And finally, $15 trillion. The United States federal debt less than a year ago. It is actually closer to $16 trillion by now. It is very hard to appreciate these numbers. Even showing them as stacks of $100 bills seems surreal once one passes a certain amount. $15 trillion is the price of building 10,000 skyscrapers like the Burj Khalifa in Dubai, which is currently the tallest building in the world. It boggles the mind. But actually, there is still more, much more, because this amount only covers government bond debt, which is only the tip of the iceberg. It does not include any other obligations, like guarantees for GSEs, government-sponsored entities, such as Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. Neither does it include unfunded liabilities of programs such as Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. Unfunded liabilities are the amount of money the government will lack in the future to fulfill all promises it has previously made, i.e., the amount of spending that is above and beyond its income, based on demographic trends and projected tax revenue. Estimates on the amount the US government would have to invest right now in order to afford payments for the next 75 years are in the tens of trillions, based on the respective trustee reports. This is the national debt many times over. And even then, these programs would be projected to run out of money after those 75 years. In my mind, those numbers speak a very clear message. This system cannot go on. Something has to give. There is another interesting aspect to government debt that has to do with the yield curve. The yield curve is the line that results from plotting the interest that some loan or bond yields per annum on the vertical axis against the time until such a loan expires and the principal has to be repaid on the horizontal axis. The shape of the yield curve is typically upward sloping, which is quite natural if one thinks about the involved risk. For example, imagine someone wants to borrow money from you, let's say for a year. You know that this person or institution is currently very reliable and has a good income, so it is very likely that you will be repaid your principal as well as the interest in 1 year's time. You are therefore willing to lend the money for a decent amount of interest. After all, it is a safe investment. On the other hand, imagine the same someone asking you to lend the money for 30 years. 30 years is a long time, and many things can happen in such a long time. The creditworthiness of your debtor might deteriorate for all kinds of reasons. His income might decrease, he might become unreliable, and so on. So you are bearing a much greater risk. If you were to lend your money for 1 year only, at the end of the year you could decide whether you want to keep lending your debtor the money for another year, or whether you would rather like to have it back. There are other variables that might influence the shape of the yield curve, such as the expected development of interest rates, inflation, and so on. But in general, a longer duration of a loan usually implies a higher annual interest rate to compensate for the extra risk one takes on. Now, if governments want to do some deficit spending, and there is seldom a time when they don't, they have to raise, that is, borrow the required money. So, a new bond is issued. But given the nature of the yield curve, one can reduce the cost of interest if one issues bonds with a short maturity. Once the bond matures, one simply issues a new bond with the same principal and uses the cash of the sale to repay the principal of the old loan. This is called to roll over debt. And as long as one is able to find a new creditor, one only has to perpetually finance the interest without ever having to repay the principal. This is in fact how governments fund their debt. And because of the structure of the yield curve, government debt has to be rolled over quite regularly. In fact, The average maturity of all debt, that is, the amount of time until the total debt has to be rolled over once, is only 5 to 7 years in most developed countries. The yield curve also explains why banking is such a profitable business. Banks borrow on the short end, lend on the long end, and pocket the difference. But of course, taking advantage of this feature of the yield curve comes at a price. While governments are able to finance their debt rather cheaply during good times, they are far less resilient in bad times and become susceptible to shocks that might lead to a vicious cycle. If the ability of some country to repay its debt is cast into doubt, perhaps even only because of some rumor, then investors suddenly perceive an investment in the debt of that country as more risky. So, they will demand a higher yield to compensate them for their risk. Now, if the country in question uses bonds with a very long maturity, it will only have to pay higher interest rates on a very small portion of its total debt, because only a small portion of that matures every year. But if the country uses bonds with a very short maturity, it has to pay a higher interest rate on its entire debt almost immediately. But of course, having to pay more interest on a loan makes the loan harder to repay. So, as that country is struggling to earn the interest on its debt becomes even more insecure in the eyes of its creditors, and so yields rise even further. So having debt that matures quickly and has to be rolled over often can easily lead to self-fulfilling prophecies, where the notion that the country might be unable to service its debt leads to higher interest rates, which in turn really impede the country's ability to service its debt. This is the reason why economists often look at bond yields of sovereigns and sound the alarm when those yields start to rise. Because soon thereafter, this vicious cycle can bankrupt the country, as it happened in Greece only a short while ago. This chart shows the yield of bonds with a 1-year maturity, issued by the Greek government. For the longest time, yields were more or less stable, but after they rose past the point of no return, they started taking off and never looked back. Nowadays, you can buy Greek bonds for less than 1/10 of the money and the interest they are actually supposed to return. So, Greece lost market access. Nobody was willing to lend to it for reasonable rates anymore. And so, to avoid default, the ECB and the IMF stepped in. They lent the Greek government money, but only if it in turn implemented austerity measures, which were supposed to make Greece regain its ability to service its debt on its own.